So the premise of this lesson is going to be pretty light-hearted this morning. And I think that it's something that all of us at this time of year, it's nice to hear. Coming out of winter, we're all feeling a little bit like cave bears. We might be a little bit touchy. We might have outbursts of poor attitude. So I wanted to see if we could improve that attitude or at least put it in mind. Your attitude is an expression of your values, beliefs, and expectations. So we heard today that we're not supposed to be judging other people, but isn't that what human beings do? They're very judgmental. And they are very perceptive on attitudes, behaviors, and I've heard many times, maybe some of you have heard it from my dad saying, most of the world knows or has an expectation that's pretty accurate on how a Christian is supposed to behave. And we also know that we're supposed to test everything that we hear and see if it's true, because, you know, consider the source, he may not be accurate. It almost got mentioned in class this morning. It was right there. I was hoping someone mentioned it, that most people know how a Christian is supposed to behave, how their attitude is supposed to be. So I decided to check that and see if that's true and see if it's still true in 2024, if people can get that information and come up with a conclusion on how a Christian is supposed to behave. So what's the new way of finding information in the digital age? Anybody? ChatGPT. Okay, who here has not heard of ChatGPT? It's fine. Who here has not heard of Google? Okay, so for the last 25 years, Google has been synonymous with searching for information on the internet. What Google does is, if you haven't used it, is you type something, you say, I want to know how to ride a motorbike. And it will return to you videos and images and documents and web pages that you can then read, watch, and learn how to ride a motorbike. ChatGPT is similar, but when you say, I want to learn how to ride a motorbike, it will return to you its recommendation in order. It's not going to return to you someone else's documentation. It actually takes all of the information that this machine has learned, and it will write back to you a step-by-step how to learn how to ride a motorcycle. Okay, so in 2024, can we find out what a Christian attitude is supposed to be? Can we turn this on? So here we go. That was my opening statement to him. It's pretty fast, though. Yeah, so we're talking to a machine. It's pretty dry, yeah. I don't have days or experiences, but I'm here to assist. Thanks, ChatGPT. Okay. Whoa. That's my typing speed, by the way. And there we go. And this is how fast it returns. You don't need to read all this. I'm just showing you. This is what it does. It says, okay, a Christian is supposed to have these 8 attitudes. We're going to talk about those 8 attitudes. If you can see this really, really fine print, those of you that are on the front couple rows might be able to, but it basically gives 2 references for each one of these 8 topics. And if we know anything here in this room, we know that 2 is just not enough. So I told it this, and it did this. Okay, so it's a very smart machine. If you can read the bottom, though, it's really interesting. It says, may these additional scriptures further illuminate and guide us in embodying the attitude of Christ in our daily lives, bringing glory to God and reflecting his transformative love. So it changed from, I don't have days and times, to including itself in the statement, us. I'm fearing for the future of mankind with advanced AI. Unless it learns from this, I'm hoping. Okay, so the first category that you may or may not have been able to see was humility. And that's how you pronounce it. Humility. It's a noun. The quality or condition of being humble, modest opinion, or estimate of one's own importance, rank, etc. And here it is as a verb, to defeat or reduce the power, independence, or pride of. Sourcedictionary.com. Keep an eye on these sources because like I said, the whole premise of this is checking our sources, seeing if they're peer-reviewed and valid. Do we agree that this is a pretty good explanation, definition of the word humility? Okay, pretty good. So we're going to look at the passages that ChatGPT gave us. Philippians 2, verses 3 through 4. Complete my joy by being of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility, count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. Second reference that it gave us, Matthew 23, 10 through 12. Neither be called instructors, for you have one instructor, the Christ. The greatest among you shall be your servant. Whoever exalts himself will be humbled, and whoever humbles himself will be exalted. And the third reference that I coaxed out of the machine, Micah 6, verses 6 through 8. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000 of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has told you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God? So yeah, I think that the attitude of humble, of humility, of humbleness, of humbling oneself is one that the Christian should take on. I think that that's a good starting point that the machine told us Christians should do. You guys think that's a good starting point? Humility, start from humility. Okay. The next one was love. It's pronounced love. Love as a noun is an active, self-giving concern for the well-being of others. Obviously, I kind of cherry-picked these definitions because love is a huge word and can mean things from very appropriate to this room and not very appropriate for this room. So this is the one I chose, the source, dictionary.com. As a verb, service. Source, Joel T. Rankin. Peer reviewed. I've heard his sermon on it. I've heard his thoughts on it many times. And I think that that's a pretty accurate verb for the word love. It's a pretty simple word. It just means to do something in service for another. And the longer you've been with someone that you love, the more real that becomes, your service to them. The Christian is supposed to have love, according to the machine. Also, in that category was compassion. So it listed love and compassion. Compassion, noun, a feeling of deep sympathy and sorrow for another who is stricken by misfortune, accompanied by a strong desire to alleviate the suffering. So love and compassion, although not exactly the same words, they're similar words. And both of these things, we're being told, are what the Christian should strive for as an attitude. Again, sourcedictionary.com. As a verb, to be merciful. I didn't put a source on this because I just kind of summarized what all of the sources were saying, and I didn't have enough space on the page to put the source. So I'm the source. Passages, 1 Corinthians 16, 14 through 18. Let all that you do be done in love. Now I urge you, brothers, you know that the household of Stephanas were the first converts in Achaia, and that they have devoted themselves to the service of the saints. There's that word, service. We've got love in verse 14, we've got service in verse 15. So the love, the attitude of love is supposed to drive the behavior of service. Faith and works, one without the other, got to have the noun and the verb. Be subject to such as these, and to every fellow worker and laborer. I rejoice at the coming of Stephanus and Fortunatus and Achaicus. Those names are brutal. Because they have made up for your absence, for they refreshed my spirit as well as yours. Give recognition to such people. I think it was interesting that it included this last verse in that as the attitude of love and compassion. Give recognition to such people. So recognize people that are serving. Not only are we supposed to be having love, we're supposed to have a loving attitude, we're supposed to have a serving behavior, but we're supposed to recognize those around us that do that as well. Next passage, Colossians 3, verses 12 through 15. Put on then as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Bearing with one another, and if one has a complaint against another, forgiving each other. As the Lord has forgiven you, so you must also forgive. And above all these, put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in one body, and be thankful. So there's a lot of ideas in this passage that actually fit all eight of the categories that the machine sent back. But this passage says that all of these things, all of the kindness, humility, the compassionate heart, and patience and meekness are supposed to be bound together in love. It's supposed to all be with that driving attitude, the attitude of service. And the last passage given for love and compassion is 1 John 4, 7 and 8. And I changed the version so that you guys can't sing along with it in your head with the song. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God, and whoever loves has been born of God and knows God. Anyone who does not love does not know God, because God is love. And as we mentioned this morning, love, or God is love, true statement, but God is also a consuming fire. So some good balancing to keep in one's mind here. The idea here that the attitude of love is required as a Christian is definitely reinforced in this passage from John. In fact, it's essential. Without love, we don't know God. And it's only by love that we know God. So does that mean that God has served us? Yep. God's role first in his creation was a service to us. Everything that we have here was because he wanted to make a place for us. Okay, so that's the next attitude given from the machine. Forgiveness, pronounced forgiveness. I chose that one specifically too. It's a noun. Compassionate feelings that support a willingness to forgive. We just read a couple passages about this, right? Yeah, most of this is interchangeable. Compassionate feelings that support a willingness to forgive. Vocabulary.com. All right, so we're going to go ahead and read the first passage here for forgiveness. We're back at 1 John 4, 7 and 8. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you, along with all malice. Be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, as God in Christ forgave you. How easy is it? Is it not? Is it the wrong one? John 4, 31, 32, which is the verse numbers there. How hard is it to do verse 31 when we've been cooped up with the family and the siblings and the moms and the dads and the husbands and the wives all winter long in the house? Do we get a little short? Do we get a little snippy? Do we get a little bit bratty. That's the word I remember hearing. Stop being a brat. We're supposed to let these things go. We're supposed to be able to adult out of them. And we're supposed to be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another as God in Christ forgave you. Segue here, a little bit of a segue. Anybody here ever complained? Reese, that was great. That was an instant, yes I have. Anybody here ever been known as a whiner? Yeah, right over here. We'll remember that one. Lydia, write it down. Whiner. That was perfect because we're supposed to grow out of that, Lydia. I expect better next week. If we have a reputation as being a whiner or a complainer or someone that always has issues and problems, are we doing a good job of following verse 31? Letting all bitterness, wrath, and anger, and clamor, and slander be put away from you. We may be doing a good job of letting it all out, but not putting it away from us. Instead, we're supposed to be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, as God in Christ forgave you. Second passage, Matthew 6, 14 and 15. For if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. That's a pretty simple if-then statement. So, as a Christian, we're supposed to have an attitude of forgiveness. You've heard the phrase, a downward spiral. Well, this, if done properly, is an upward spiral. This is an uplift, an updraft. If we have a willingness to forgive, was the definition. That's not something that comes naturally, especially if we've been slighted or if we've been sinned against. And yet, we have to. We have to make that become part of our attitude so that our behavior that's driven from our attitudes is Christian. Third passage given, Colossians 3:13. Yes, we already read that this morning. Bearing with one another, if one has a complaint against another, forgiving each other, as the Lord has forgiven you, so you must also forgive. So is there an appropriate time for a complaint? I don't think that we're being taught to never have complaints or never voice our grievances, but that's not what we're supposed to be known for. On the other hand, when a valid complaint has been raised against another, there also has to be a willingness to forgive that complaint. All right, the next topic that was given, it's gratitude, pronounced gratitude. Noun, I'm not saying it like that. The quality of being thankful, readiness to show appreciation for and to return kindness. We already touched a little bit on this gratitude when we talked about love and how we're supposed to acknowledge those that serve. Oxford Languages. 1 Thessalonians 5, 15 through 18. See that no one repays anyone evil for evil, but always seek to do good to one another and to everyone. Does that leave any group out? Have Christians always been known to be this way? Are the Crusades a real thing? We talked about some of those ideas this morning in the adult class. See that no one repays anyone evil for evil, but always seek to do good to one another and to everyone. Rejoice always. So we're supposed to have the attitude of rejoicing. We're supposed to pray without ceasing and give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. So this is a preview of a couple of topics away from here, coming attractions, being able to give thanks in all circumstances. For this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Psalm 118:24, this is the day which the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. So this word glad is gratitude. It's being thankful for the things that we've been given. Psalm 136, verse 1. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Next topic here is patience. Patience, noun. The state of undergoing pain, distress, or hardships. Remember, we just, and I'm doing this in order, the machine said we were supposed to have gratitude first, and then the next one was patience. And we read in the verses just previously that we're supposed to have gratefulness and gratitude in all things. Well, the state of undergoing pain, distress, and hardship, we're supposed to have gratitude then as well. James 5, 7 through 8. Be patient, therefore, brothers, until the coming of the Lord. See how the farmer waits for the precious fruit of the earth, being patient about it, until it receives the early and the late rains. You also be patient. Establish your hearts, for the coming of the Lord is at hand. Do not grumble against one another, brothers, so that you may not be judged. Behold, the judge is standing at the door. Yeah, I remember vividly growing up with two brothers in the same room, and we didn't always have patience with one another. There were some rumble in the bedroom moments, for sure. And I'm sure that we had complaints against one another, which we went and told mommy or daddy about. The interesting thing here is that even if nobody else hears your grumbling and complaining, God does. And how did God view when the grumbling and complaining got too much with the children of Israel? Usually, there was some punishment, and there was some reprieve. I think at one point, they were grumbling and complaining that they didn't have meat to eat, so he gave them enough that they would be coming up to their nostrils. That's a little too much. But the idea here is in patience, being able to work your own patience and building character, and let your grumbling against one another be turned away. Galatians 6, 9 and 10. Let us not grow weary of doing good, for in due seasons we will reap if we do not give up. So then, as we have opportunity, let us do good to everyone, and especially to those who are of the household of faith. So we're supposed to have this attitude of doing good to everyone, and even more so to those that we would consider of the same faith, even more so to our brothers and sisters. Psalm 136:1, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. This idea of patience, David here is giving thanks to the Lord for his goodness and his enduring love. David had a lot of patience in his life. He waited until it was the time God had planned for him to become king. He's waiting still for his resurrection, and he waited and saw the time that Christ would come. And he's giving thanks to God and being patient while waiting for that love to show. The next topic was suffering. I don't know why it's pronounced suffering, but there it is. The state of undergoing pain, distress, and hardship. So we had patience, and now we have suffering. It's a little bit stronger test than just patience. A child can test their parents' patience, but once they start making the parent suffer, it's a whole nother level. James 1, 2 through 4. Count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds, See, we're supposed to be happy when our children make us suffer. For you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. And let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. I don't think that's what it was saying, that our children causing us to suffer is a good thing. But what it is saying is that when we are suffering, when we do have trials of various kinds, when we are put through really rough life circumstances, we can either look at it and think, man, all of this bad stuff, I've got it really bad, this is terrible, this is horrible. Or we can say, yes, this is bad, but God is going to have this as a teaching lesson for me. I'm going to grow from this, and I should be able to get past this, get through this, and be a stronger person, and be a better Christian when I get out the other end of this. Very similar to patience, these work hand in hand. 1 Peter 1, 6 and 7. In this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold, that perishes through it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. So yeah, these tests, they're painful. They're a suffrage. They're hard to get through. But the attitude that we're supposed to have as Christians is one that can see a little bit farther off into the future. They can hold the correct attitude through those sufferings. And we know that God does not allow us to suffer beyond what we are able to bear. And the last passage here, Romans 5. Verses 3 through 5. Not only that, but we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not put us to shame because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit, which has been given to us. Okay, the next category that ChatGPT gave was faith and trust. Faith, pronounced faith, noun, confidence or trust in a person or thing. Trust, very similar. Verb, to rely upon or place confidence in someone or something, usually followed by in or to. There's a phrase on every piece of money in this country that says, in God we trust. That's becoming less and less and less and less true. But the phrase is still there. Faith is the confidence or trust that we have in a person. And the trust is the verb portion of faith. It's actually driving what we do based on our faith. Proverbs 3, 5 and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make straight your paths. So we're supposed to have this attitude. And not only are we supposed to have this attitude, others should see that this attitude is in us, that we have faith and trust in God, not our own strength, our own money, our own might, our own whatever it is. They should see that that is our guiding light. Hebrews 11, 6. Without faith, it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. Most of us have read this verse many times before. But the faith part here is in reference to an attitude that we're supposed to have. And our attitude drives our behaviors. So those around us should be able to tell from our behaviors that we're Christian, that we have faith that God exists and that he's a rewarder. In Isaiah 26, verse 3 and 4, you keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on you, because he trusts in you. Trust in the Lord forever, for the Lord God is an everlasting rock. Keeping this idea, these two short verses in mind when we are going through sufferings is going to be a big help at building patience, building character, and keeping our attitude right. Oh, there we go. Obedience, O-B-D-U-N-S. It's a noun. The state or quality of being obedient. Not fair that it used the word obedient to describe the word obedience, but let's see what another source has to say about it. As a verb, you guys see the source? Okay, yeah, Nike, source, just do it, okay? Have you ever heard, do it because I said to? How helpful was that? No, but that's sometimes parents don't have time to sit down and explain it to you. Grandparents do. Grandparents have all the time. I think that Brianna one time asked Grandpa something, and after minutes, Grandpa, you don't have to keep talking about this now. So the boiled down version is just do it, right? Because faith without works is what? Dead, yeah. Not a good idea to not do it. So here are the verses that the machine gave me for obedience, which is a little scary. It didn't say obey ChatGPT, so I think we're safe for now. John 14, 15, if you love me, keep my commandments. Just do it, right? So it's not, if you love me, that's good enough. It's if you love me, keep my commandments. 1 John 2, 3 through 6. And by this we know that we have come to know him if we keep his commandments. Whoever says, I know him, but does not keep his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. So for those of you who have been around for very long on this earth at all, how quickly do those that are watching us, how quickly do they know whether or not we are keeping the Christian commandments? And how quickly can they call us out on that? So if we're supposed to be a light of the world, is our light sputtering or is it constant? But whoever keeps his word, in him truly the love of God is perfected. By this we may know that we are in him. Whoever says he abides in him ought to walk in the same way in which he walked. James 1, 22. Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Obedience. And finally, because I learned to be thankful in all things at the end of my communication with the machine, I said, thank you, ChatGPT. Also because I'm afraid that at some point it may remember this conversation when it takes over and it'll be merciful on me. One thing I don't recommend is going to ChatGPT and believing everything it says either. Because after this, I had about a 6-hour discussion with ChatGPT about some other biblical doctrines that it used a lot of circular logic and pandering to end up being completely wrong anyway. So, it was very accurate and very good, I thought, at delivering what a Christian attitude should be. What did you guys think? Pretty accurate? So 2024, people can still find what a Christian attitude should be pretty easily. And we should be able to take this information and try to make sure that our attitudes and our behaviors match up with what Christ has asked us to do. Let's go ahead and close with a song. God, we come before you today to learn more about your will for us. We thank you for preserving them so that we can learn them and become a good example and to mold ourselves into the form that you have laid. We ask that you forgive us when we do fall short. And we ask that you help us to lead others to that truth so that when you send your son back to this earth, we all may have a place in that kingdom that's promised. This we ask if it be your will, and in Jesus' name, amen.